Oh, Bob, thank you so much for inviting us down to the wonderful Under the Apple Tree studio. It's
It's a pleasure, Dan.
great to be here. It's an amazing studio. I mean, the record collection is incredible. I mean, you must have some amazing memories on these shelves.
Yeah, it's well put, actually. The shelves are memory packed, and I got my vinyl collection as well. So this CD collection has been building up now. I mean, since the start of CDs in like 85, I've been collecting ever since. So, and this isn't all of it. It's spilled over into other parts of the house and the garage and everything. So,
You've had some amazing artists in here as well, some of my favourites. You must be closing in on 250 sessions, isn't there?
it's more, it's
Is
closing
it
in on
really? Oh, wow,
350.
that's amazing.
Yeah, I mean, the start of it actually was my son Miles was doing an internet radio program. And we started to think what a good idea it would be for him to do sessions down here. And the first one was Christian Bush, who was over for the CMA Songwriters Workshop. It was about 3 years ago, I think, maybe even longer. And Christian came down, did a great interview, played. And Miles and I began to think maybe we should put cameras on this. And that's how it started. So it started very modestly, but we then just began to invite our friends and musicians that we like to come down and play. And of course, then that means that, or meant that, we were catching people in the very early days that have now developed into big stars. You know, the Shires came down here right early days, Ward Thomas, and some favorites like Judith Owen and Ellen and the Escapades, who is suddenly now broken up. I mean, we've had some great sessions here, and uniquely, what we suggest to people that they do, we always like them to do some sort of cover version. And the suggestion is that they play a version of the first song they ever learned. And that then produces some amazing moments. And I think my absolute favorite, Thea Gilmore, was here about a year and a half ago, and she did a version of Sweet Child of Mine, the Guns N' Roses track. And she transformed it into a beautiful lullaby. I mean, it really is gorgeous. If you're ever exploring Under the Apple Tree sessions, because as you know, we've got our YouTube channel, check that one out in particular. It's absolutely glorious with Nigel Stoney on, accompanying acoustic guitar. So, yeah, we've had lots of very magic
I
moments here.
remember the Shires doing the Young Hearts Run Free as well.
Yeah,
It's a, I think
yeah.
that's your most viewed video on YouTube now, isn't it? I think
I think it is, although
it's
there's a wonderful young artist called Victoria Canal
yeah.
who came in m much more recently, only about a month ago. And on Facebook, her session has got way over 100,000 views, which is fantastic. So yeah,
Amazing.
we're really pleased. I mean, it's Miles. Miles curates and films, mixes, edits, posts, So it's really, he's the curator.
Now, obviously, there's so much we can talk about, but we want to focus on the countryside of things, being a country website. So, what was it that kick-started your passion for country music all those years ago? What was the moment for you?
Well, I think I didn't realize it necessarily at the time, but when I was buying my first batch of vinyl singles in the 50s, rock and roll singles, I mean, I started buying records in 1957. And I was buying Buddy Holly, the Everly Brothers, Jerry Lee Lewis, Ricky Nelson. And all of these artists had come up through country. Their background was country music, ditto Elvis in many ways. I mean, you look at the first Elvis single with That's All Right on one side, so that's a foot in the R&B camp, and Blue Moon of Kentucky on the other side, which was the old Bill Monroe bluegrass track. And there, in a way, you've got them sort of mini synthesis of what rock and roll became, this blend of country and R&B. And I was very into those artists who, well, they were kind of country artists. I now play the Everly Brothers on my country show because they topped the country charts with those singles that I was buying at the time. And then the other sort of key record that began to, as it were, introduce me to the notion and idea of a Nashville sound was Blonde on Blonde by Bob Dylan. And then obviously, of course, Nashville Skyline, Gram Parsons with the Byrds, Sweetheart of the Rodeo, that country rock thing of the late 60s, early 70s that we were massively supporting on Whistle Test, you know, the Eagles and Poco and New Riders of the Purple Sage and Hot Tuna. Harvest by Neil Young is a country album, you know, made in Nashville again. And so it was kind of, without even completely knowing it, it was sort of in my DNA. So when I started doing the overnights on Radio 1 in the early 1990s, by now we've got a new generation of people like Mary Chapin Carpenter, Sean Colvin, Steve Earle, Guy Clark. You know, these people were regularly appearing on my show in session. So when I went to Radio 2, once I'd settled in there, the deputy controller at the time of Radio 2, Leslie Douglas, had been a big fan of my overnight shows, and that's where she'd heard people like Susie Boggess and Waylon Patton and people like this, you know. So she was looking to bring a slightly different approach to the country show. And by now, Americana has begun to kick in, you know, Car Wheels on a Gravel Road has just come out, and Leslie in her mind just made connections, all these connections together, and said, right, you know, we'd like you to do the country show, and we'd like you to bring exactly this music mix into the program. So, you know, we'll call it Bob Harris Country, and then it obviously it reflects your own personal taste. So that's how it sort of all evolved. So there wasn't really a trigger moment. I just realized that, well, if there was a trigger moment, if there was a sort of epiphany, it was when I touched down in Nashville and got to Nashville for the first time in 99 and realized this is my spiritual home. And I blessed the day, you know, that Radio 2 asked me to take over the country show. It's just been one of the best things that ever happened to me.
Amazing. Well, in the 70s and 80s, obviously country had quite a lot of mainstream success with Kenny and Dolly having hits there, here, there and everywhere. But then there was a bit of a decline. And as we all know, it's been a bit of a struggle for country music in a lot of aspects. So what do you think caused that decline?
Gosh, that's a multifaceted question. I don't think there's one specific reason for it, to be honest. I think the if you like, the really sort of creative spark energy was happening probably just to the side then, as it's always done really. But you know, in the 70s you got Outlaw Country, which if you're looking for kind of the real dusty gritty stuff, that would probably be it. And it never really caught fire here. What we got in the 70s was Dolly, you know, the occasional hit from Kenny Rogers and or Tammy Wynette or Jeannie C. Riley or Bobby Gentry, I guess. But there wasn't, if you like, I don't think, there wasn't a movement in that way. And then as you get into the 80s, you've got a complete split with you know, that John Travolta film in 1980, you know, that brought the idea of that sort of whole line dancing mentality into play. But at the same time, you've got all the Texan singer-songwriters that are now beginning to emerge, but hadn't yet made a big impact here. You know, Guy Clark, Steve Earle, Nancy Griffith, you know, they hadn't hit home here yet. So what we were left with was really the kind of big hat thing that, I don't know, you know, the vast majority of people here hadn't connected with. So it wasn't until, I don't think, the early 90s, a new country, if you like, to put it that way, began to come through, and Garth Brooks and George Strait, Alan Jackson, there was more of a awareness of them. But I think Americana and then the change of mindset of Nashville musicians that suddenly made it cool to reach out a little bit and come over to the UK and play. And once they began to establish that bridge, then we got artists coming over more and more. And then the new generation began to take over. And they're the ones that have brought all the new young fans into the music. So
what was it like as a British broadcaster going over to Nashville for the first time when you started doing the country show? Did they find it quite unusual that somebody was coming over and covering country music? How were you received over there?
Well, the BBC carries a fantastic reputation with it, to be honest. So it was more the BBC and at the time, Radio 2 was covering CMAs live. We were backstage in the little studio, Grand Ole Opry, and all the artists would come through and see us. So there was a very, very warm reaction to what we were doing in Nashville at the time.
And I mean, fast forward into where we are now with C2C, I mean, it's hugely popular, but how did your involvement with C2C start 5 years ago?
That, I think that my country show has been one of the platforms upon which, you know, country has grown in Britain. And then when they began to get the idea for Country to Country and reached out to Radio 2 for coverage, I was asked to be the main stage compere, and it seemed, you know, logical to do that. And then once C2C got established, we then began to take Under the Apple Tree into the O2 with us. We had our own stage there for 3 years running. And so I'm completely entwined with the fabric of C2C, and I absolutely love it. Yeah, I think it's brilliant.
When it first started 5 years ago, did you think it was quite an optimistic venture to put something on in a 20,000 seat arena?
It seemed to make sense though now. By this point, you know, I think it's important to mark one or two signposts. I think Taylor Swift was massively important in terms of bringing this music to a younger generation, particularly young girls. You know, my daughter Flo is 20 next month, and she was massively into Taylor Swift. She loved Taylor Swift's records and still does, actually, those country songs. And then Kacey Musgraves, now Maren Morris. You know, you've got young girls being able to relate to these artists, and then you've got young male artists that are bringing real excitement in with them. So I'm looking out from the stage at the first audience gathering for the first ever C2C. Christian Bush was the first person out onto that first stage. And you look out and the top tiers of the O2 are blacked out. Yeah, it's pretty chunky. It's enough. You're looking through the weekend thinking this is enough to sustain it. But there wasn't an incredible level of excitement. But the tipping point happened during the Zac Brown set. 3 years ago, I think it was, that Zac Brown did a cover of Kashmir by Led Zeppelin. And then later in the set, it was Enter Sandman by Metallica. And I was watching from the side of the stage, huge chunks of the audience got up and left. And the following year, Florida Georgia Line were playing and Luke Bryan, and all those empty seats were filled by an entirely new, young, excited generation of country music fans. And that was the tipping point. And I think it had to kind of be that way. The young generation are taking country music over now, and they're the people that are going to take it into the future. And, you know, I'm all for this. I think it's just so great.
Yeah. Well, the general reaction from this year's festival was that it was the best ever. I mean, we had so many great moments this year. Darius doing Purple Rain and Zac Brown absolutely raising the roof again. So is that something you agree with, that it was the best year so far?
Totally. And you know, it sounds a bit of a cliche to say, but the thing that I absolutely get from country to country is the fans, is the level of excitement and enjoyment you find as you walk into the O2 and you've got, you know, the outer ring, all the pop-up stages, it's packed with people, all the little venues, people spilling out, cacophony of sound everywhere. And just the level of love for the music. And see, I get this a lot, obviously, if I'm walking through, people will come over, they recognize me, they, you know, they're aware of the country show, obviously, but probably heard a lot of the artists that are playing that night on my show first. And so I'm getting this reaction coming at me, and it's just fantastic. I just really, I take my hat off to the fans, because they're the people that are making all this happen, their enthusiasm.
Yeah. And do you get the impression that C2C is kind of making an impression in the States now? Do the artists see it as a must visit festival?
Oh, absolutely huge. Yeah, I mean, crucially, country to country aligns with the CMAs. So you've got CMA backing, Country Music Association backing. And that is important to state that, because then they will encourage the bigger names to make the trip. And because C2C is in, it's in London, it's in Glasgow, Dublin, last year and the year before, I think a couple of European cities as well. When you put that package together, financially also, you've got to factor that in. It makes sense for the artists to come over. They can come over with their big show. They don't have to scrimp or do acoustic. They can come over with their big band and do it all justice. So, yeah, I mean, the whole event of C2C, because there are obviously the songwriters' night on Thursday evening, CMA meetings all around the event itself. So it's a huge country music landmark event for British country.
What an opportunity it is for the British artists as well at C2C. I know you've been very much involved in that the last few years.
Absolutely. I mean, the pop-up stages. It's what's exciting, I think, about, you know, country music in Britain is the fact that it does have its own styles now. It has its own identity, and it isn't the way that it was maybe 5 or 10 years ago, where you see UK artists trying to be American. The UK artists now have got their own sense of what the music should be. Look at the Shires, you know, even the name. It's an English name, the Shires, Ward Thomas. These artists, they're taking their influences from more recent acts. I mean, for example, with the Shires, I think the wellspring for them is the Civil Wars. I think Joy and John Paul have been massively influential. Look at Lewis and Lee. It's, you know, sort of same kind of thing. But we've been right behind so many of the artists. I mean, Robert Vincent was my emerging artist at the Americana Music Awards last year. And I love Dexeter. You know, we do Under the Apple Tree session nights at a studio that we've gone into partnership with in Harrogate called The Warehouse Studios. And Dexeter have become more or less our house band. So we are massively behind this arrival of these great new UK artists, yeah.
The one slightly frustrating aspect of C2C is, because obviously we go around the country following country artists here, there and everywhere, and you see 20,000 people at C2C, but sometimes you go to a gig and there's more people on stage than there is in the crowd at times. Mm. And how do you think we get around that problem? Because it's such a struggle for the British artists still. Do you think there's a stigma attached to UK artists in any way?
No, I don't. Honestly, yeah. I don't. I think the problem of monetizing the music is a problem that is now universal, to be honest. I mean, being involved here and in America with the Americana Music Association, one of the big challenges is for those artists to be making money. How do you do that? You know, it's not the easiest thing, but it's not that there's any resistance here, I don't think. It's a general, because traditionally artists used to sign to labels, they would have tours underwritten. I mean, that's happened to the Shires and Ward Thomas, obviously, but when you know, some of the younger, newer artists don't have that luxury. So how do they pay for the petrol in the van and what, you know, you've just got to, there's no easy answer to it. There are so many social media opportunities now where you can get word of your music out. You've got a merch desk at the back of each gig that hopefully you're packed with stuff, CDs. And the merch desk, I think, is one of the most important aspects of a gig now, is selling those CDs and using the money from those CDs to get you to the next gig. And then you're building your fan base, this Nashville way of explaining this, but you're building a fan base one fan at a time. And if you're prepared to do that, Callahan, you know, is a fantastic example of the way to make this work, building up a database, email addresses, meeting people directly, going to house concerts, doing it day after day after day after day through 2 or 3 years, and gradually building a fan base that then, when you say, for example, crowdfund, you've got this base that you can tap into to say, hey, we're just about to go into make our next album. Give us a hand. We'll give you a credit. You'll get a copy, etc. So, yeah, I mean, it is a problem, but there are ways around it. And I certainly I don't think it's exclusive to the UK.
Yeah, it's quite refreshing now to see all these festivals popping up as well. You've obviously got Brooklyn Boots and FSA Fest, and
it's fabulous. It's just fabulous. I mean, the activity over the last 4 or 5 years in broadcasting as well. You know, Radio 2's got the pop up, the digital station now. There are broadcasters coming in to the music that weren't there 3 or 4 years ago. You know, Balin Leonard, Balin's terrific. You've got a new station, Chris Country, you know. Yeah. It's fantastic to see.
And obviously an artist that you've pushed from the start is the Shires, who are obviously having massive success now. Mm. I've just been signed to Big Machine. So yeah. How far do you actually think the Shires can go with the backing of Scott Buschetta?
It's crucial, isn't it, that Scott's got involved. I mean, there's everything is right about the Shires. Ben writes, they both write fantastic songs. They look great. They complement each other as a couple in that way, visually, perfectly. I mean, they do look fabulous. They've got an energy and enthusiasm about them. They're prepared to work, and they really, really want it. So you've got this fabulous mix of commitment and great music. And that's what I think Scott recognised. And the next thing, obviously, now is for them to start cracking America. I mean, I think they'll do really well there.
Yeah. It was interesting watching their documentary, actually. They were in that writer's session, and they were saying that they might have to change their sound slightly in America.
Yeah.
I think that's something
I saw that too. I mean, it's so difficult. This is a big dilemma for artists when they get signed by a label. How much do you want to surrender to that kind of opinion versus how much you want to stick with what you know is right for you? It's a dilemma. I was aware of that too, watching the film. Yeah, because that's the pressure that comes to play on any emerging artists, really. If you're going to sign to a big label, then they are going to want say over the way you are.
It's going to be difficult for them, isn't it?
Yeah,
we've got faith, they'll do it. But talking about the modern sound of country music, I mean, there's a lot of artists now, particularly the likes of FGL, Sam Hunt, Thomas Rhett, they really push the boundaries, and it's not necessarily what you would be playing on your country show 10, 15 years ago. So what's your opinion on that, on the modern sound?
Well, again, when you look back over country historically, country music has had an almost unique ability to absorb influences from outside it without those influences spoiling what country music actually is. We've seen it right the way through the years. And that's what's happening now. I mean, that's what was happening that night watching the Zac Brown Band on stage at C2C, playing Enter Sandman and playing Kashmir, because those records were among the records that those guys grew up with. Same with Eric Church. You know, Eric has introduced even an element of progressive rock into some of his stuff, which is an unexpected collision. But I massively defend the right of these artists to do that, because why should they shut their minds off to the music that's influenced them to where they are now? They've grown up in, you know, Thomas Rhett, for example. Thomas's dad was a writer. Thomas has been in Nashville and around the Nashville sound forever. So that it's in his DNA. But at the same time, he's grown up listening to other styles of music, and he's sort of cherry picking some of that stuff to introduce into his own music. And even with Sam Hunt, you know, the people say, oh, well, Sam's kind of borrowing from rap. Yes and no is the answer to that. When he was sort of demoing songs, or when he co-writes, occasionally if Sam comes up with a lyric, before he sings it, he'll talk it. Just speak it to see the way that it scans and And co-writers began to say, you know, it's effective when you do that. So why don't you draw attention occasionally to this particular lyric line by sort of bringing the music back and saying it and then going back into the music again. And that's what Sam has done. And by doing that, okay, you know, he's actually developed quite an individual way and sound. So I'm totally open-minded to all of this. And I think that if there was a danger for country music maybe 5 or 10 years ago, it was the protectionists saying, you're not allowed to let country music evolve. Well, country music is constantly evolving, and that's what we're seeing now. And that's what's going to take it into the future.
But obviously it's so refreshing to see, I mean, Sturgill winning a Grammy and Brothers Osborne knocking Florida Georgia Line off their perch at the award shows. And obviously Sam Outlaw's done so well in the UK recently. So yeah, there must still be an appetite for that traditional raw country.
Oh, absolutely. And you know, you look at people like Cale Tyson. I love Carter Sampson's music. I think it's fantastic, you know. Funnily enough, talking about the Brothers Osborne, that's one of the things, again, that we've seen change in Nashville. Because when I first went out to cover the CMAs, those artists, the artist lists, the nominations, the nominees, had remained pretty static for many, many years up to that point. I think there was massive news at one point that Montgomery Gentry had got Duo of the Year, replacing Brooks and Dunn, bringing to an end, I think it was a 13-year winning streak as Duo of the Year. And then the following year, Brooks and Dunn took back over again. I mean, that's how it was then. It's changed so much, you know, so much new energy. And you saw that this year with Blimey. I mean, it takes quite a lot to knock Florida Georgia Line off their perch. But yeah, and again, you know, I think it's so great that this is happening.
It's amazing. And obviously we can't go without mentioning your CMA award for International Broadcaster of the Year, so congratulations on that.
Thank you.
Must be an honour. I mean, I know you've won it before, but it must still surprise you to get that recognition.
Well, when you think, it's quite mind-blowing actually, because of all the country music presenters right across the world, there's a big selection panel. This is what I'm told anyway, the selection panel whittles it down to a shortlist, and then from that shortlist you get the International Broadcaster of the Year. So the opposition is huge, it really is. And this year was my fourth, actually, over the last sort of 12 years. And whereas maybe 12 years ago you could say, well, there weren't as many programs then as they are now, but there are a lot now. And so the competition has intensified, and yet still I've won it for the last 2 years. So not winning it next year will be a blow. But actually, I mean, you don't expect to, do you know what I mean? It's the second you think, oh, well, it's a given. No, it so isn't. And I think that among the contenders next year will be Palin. And I think Chris Country, you know, absolutely should come under the spotlight of consideration. Because what he's done, I think it's fantastic what Chris has done, really. I mean, starting a radio station more or less in your own bedroom, and it building to be registered on Radar, to be a part of the Radio 2 R2 Country 4 days, for us to highlight Chris. Do you know what I mean? I mean, it's, and Balin, I think, well, I mean, I'm a massive fan of Balin. So if either of those two from this country take over next year, I'll be absolutely delighted. Yeah.
Balin's got his Nashville Meets London festival coming up again soon, hasn't he?
Yes, he has.
And he's going to announce the lineup soon.
So yeah. And the other thing about Balin is, you know, his roots run really deep. Again, it's DNA, you know, he grew up with this music. He's incredibly knowledgeable and has got a great ear, so yeah.
Yeah, we love Balin. Yeah. Well, just before we go, I put it out on social media the other day. I got a few people sending some questions.
Oh, okay.
So do you mind if we do that?
Yeah.
Keith Biggs on Facebook wants to ask, why don't the BBC film C2C?
It's a very sort of long and complicated story, but it distills into basically clearances. You know, you've got a lineup here of absolutely massive stars, obviously, each of whom have their priorities in terms of sound, look, getting a consensus across all these artists to provide the clearances to show their performances is nothing like as easy as it sounds as if it might be. More though, I think there's a very strong probability now that the BBC will cover CMA this year, and will start to cover the CMA Awards ongoing, which would be fantastic. And of course, we've got our own AMA Awards in the UK annually now. That's February. And we're also hoping that further down the line, we might get some television coverage of that. But C2C is more complicated. It just is, you know.
Okay. James Dakin wants to know, who do you think the next Shire/Ward Thomas will be? Have you got your eye on
anybody? Oh, well, I hope Dexeter. You know, Dexeter, Lewis and Lee, my two absolute... Lewis and Lee, they're so subtle and so... They're just so right. Dexeter rock. They rock out. And, of course, Robert Vincent. I'm such a massive fan of Robert's. But there is this lovely new generation of artists that have come through now. It's a fantastic moment.
And another one from James. He said, who would you like to see at C2C next year as a fan?
Alison Krauss. I'd love to see Alison Krauss.
Her new album's amazing.
It really is, yeah. Keith Urban. See, Keith is... I mean, Keith sees Britain, though, more as coming over to do a tour. But I think he would be fabulous.
And Paul Hadley says, are you doing any more Cadogan Hall shows this year?
Yes, we are. Yeah. We're hoping perhaps even to have another festival day later this year. We're not sure about that yet. But certainly the idea is to promote certain concerts there, as we have been doing. So, yes, the answer is yes, we will be.
He'll be happy about that.
Yeah.
Sue Bell says, what do you look for in upcoming artists and how do they get on your radar?
Mostly post. Well, people coming in here is a first-hand way of seeing and listening to young artists, is to have them come in here and sit at the back while Miles is filming and listen. I get a lot of post. I mean, a couple of hundred CDs a week. I know that sounds unlikely, but that is the truth of it. Because I think people all over the world have obviously identified the fact that there's this show going out on Radio 2, and maybe they should send me their new CD, so they do. So I get a lot of personal recommendation too. We've all got our tastemakers, people whose opinion we trust. So if somebody that I've worked with now right the way through on the country show has been around the programme for years, Richard Wootton. Richard got a CMA this year for his work for country music. And again, Richard knows the genre inside out. And if he calls me up and said, you wait till you hear this album, I can't wait to hear it, because Richard has recommended it and he's very rarely wrong. So, and of course, my own producer, Mark Hagen, Mark spends a lot of time in Nashville. So in other words, I'm absorbing lots and lots of suggestions and influences from people to make the final selections, which I do here in the studio. I always build the programs here, so yeah.
Okay. And Jane Scoffin, this is a good one. She says, if you could invite four country artists to an intimate dinner party, who would you invite and why?
God, that is a good question, isn't it? Wow. Well, you'd have to have stories. You'd have to have Willie Nelson there. There's no way that we couldn't have Willie there. There's that at CMA last year, when Dolly Parton was describing him getting his award as a career high, and Willie's seen so many highs, it borders on the, what was the word she used, the momentous or something. So, but no, you'd have to have Willie there, I think. That would be, I would definitely invite Kacey Musgraves, because she's so, she's just so lovely to have around. And she does have a sense of the tradition of country. So those would be Steve Earle, for more tales of death and destruction. And probably if you're balancing it up, one would need to have a female artist as well. Actually, I'd probably say Alison Krauss, because of course Alison's connection with bluegrass and the bridge across into rock. You know, she grew up with Led Zeppelin. Her older brother loved Led Zeppelin. So the connection with Robert Plant wasn't as unexpected as perhaps, you know, you would expect. But T-Bone Burnett was also a massive catalyst. And if I could extend the table by one chair, I'd probably also include T-Bone Burnett, because he is, yeah, again, T-Bone, his knowledge of music and the range of artists that he's worked with over the years. So that, I think that would be a pretty good dinner party, actually.
And just the last one. She says, "What's your favourite venue in Nashville that's off the beaten path for gigs?"
Station Inn, probably. I love the Station Inn. It's amazing now that you know, the Nashville is has been expanding, as we know, at a massive rate, and they're bulldozing a lot of the old buildings down, and you're getting Nashville always used to be low rise. I mean, you look at the old Nashville skyline, it's low rise, but they're putting up all these massive high great condos now. And the Station Inn is a very small, very incongruous looking white building in the middle of what's now become high rise city. It is amazing. It stands out now, the Station Inn, like a sore thumb in the environment that it's in, with all these condos and swish restaurants and everything else. But the Station Inn is so funky, and once you get inside there, and it's mostly bluegrass that's played there, and unamplified, it's a fantastic place to go, and or anywhere the Time Jumpers are playing. Because the Time Jumpers used to have a residency at the Station Inn. I think they now play at Third and Lindsay, but they play on a Monday night. And it's a loose association of great musicians who just gather together for the crack. Yeah. So wherever the Time Jumpers are playing, that is a great venue. Go and see them.
That's awesome.
yeah
Jane, go and visit the Station Inn. Well, Bob, it's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you for having us.
Thanks,
It's
Dan. I've
been a great
enjoyed
chat.
it.
It's
yeah
awesome. So thanks for having us,
thank you
and
very
we'll speak
much.
to you again very soon, hopefully.
Absolutely.
Thank you.